Hey everybody, this is Grimcad, and I'm coming to you with a new game, sort of. This is Dominions 4. Now, this is the game that Conquest of Elysium is sort of based on. It's the same world. This is a similar game, but it's a higher level grand strategy. It's always been a little near and dear to my heart. I've played a lot of it. So I think I am going to do a let's play of this and as well as Conquest of Elysium 4. Now, I have disabled the sound on this because for whatever reason, the way I record, I use Fraps, the sound of this is always way, 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 way too loud on this game. But the music's kind of nice. It's a bit repetitive, but all right. So, we're going to be playing on a custom map called Bidden. It's created by PyMouse. He's created a bunch of mods for this and helped compile even more, I believe. So, this is a good one for 4 to 8 land nations. So, I think we're probably going to play with 5. We're not going to do a game that lasts forever. Listen to the sound of my drawer as I pull it out, and we'll call this Let's Play. So we can easily remember. Oh, of course, I can't use an apostrophe. Probably can't even use a space. I can use a space. So as you're getting into this, there are 3 different eras that we can start playing in: early age, middle age, late age, as you can see. Early age has the most powerful magic. But it's like bronze level technology for the most part. Middle age is in between, and late age has the worst magic, but has more like iron and stuff like that. So when you're choosing, each era has unique civilizations to be. Some of them follow throughout. For example, in the early age, you have Ulm, and then as you get towards the late age, you still have Ulm. Although from one era to the another era, they change in a good deal. So we're gonna pick the early ages. The early ages are full of magic and civilization is at its beginning. At most places, iron has not been thought of yet, and armors and weapons are made of wood, stone, and bronze. Mages are most powerful in this age, and there is an abundance of magic resources. It is a time of legends. Oh, I also forgot, we are playing with a mod. We're playing with Magic Enhanced. So each faction has unique spells to them, a lot of the times in the form of summons, occasionally damaging items, definitely very flavorful things though, and we'll be doing with that. Oh. Oh, but I don't have to name it again. Great. Yes, I do. We are going to be doing early ages. We're going to add, oh, 5 more people. They're all going to be random. A random land nation, because I don't think anything will support, or excuse me, this map will support water nation. And we are going to be a faction that I have not been before. Well, except for test. I did a little practice on it, but you know. It is what it is. We're going to be Niefelheim, the Sons of Winter. Oh, don't I get an interview? Or preview? Maybe I get it next time. Ah! Hinnom is a dry wasteland inhabited by giants. At the dawn of time, on the sacred Mount Hermon, 6 angels in full celestial splendor descended to aid and instruct the giants of the land. The Avum were a people strong and beautiful of mind and body. They were adept students, and their culture flourished under the tutelage of Grigori, the angelic watchers. But before long, the angels became enamored with the Avum and taught them things that should not have been taught. Tempted by the beauty of the Avum, they took their daughters as wives and sinned before the celestial powers. Their offspring were the Niefelheim, giants of godlike power, abominable to the world. The angels were imprisoned in the infernal realms for their sins, but the Niefelheim were partly of this world and could not be banished by the celestial powers. Wait, this isn't the right one. How silly. That is the wrong god entirely, or faction entirely. What was it? Oh my goodness. What was I gonna be? That wasn't it. That wasn't it either. Oh yeah. What did I hit? I must have hit Nom. Yeah. Whoops. This is Niefelheim, Sons of Winter. Niefelheim, the land of eternal frost, was once the home of the frost giants, the Rimturusar, ancient giants who possessed godlike powers, were the undisputed rulers of the world. The giants of Jotunheim are the descendants of the Rimturusar. From the cold glaciers in Niefelheim, frost giants have emerged anew. These Niefel giants are not nearly as powerful as their ancestors, but they are stronger by far than the giants of later ages. Giants are immensely strong and resilient, but their size makes them easy targets. They are born in the cold and do not suffer from cold climates. Niefelheim is used by several jarls, who rarely join forces. Gyges, old and wicked hags, serve the Niefel giants with sorcerous advice. The people of Niefelheim prefer to live in very cold provinces. The icy winds of Niefelheim cause the cold climate to expand beyond the dominion of the predator god. They are cold resistant, they need lots of supplies, and they prefer a cold scale of 3+. Our military is giants, giant infantry, and our magic is water, blood, death, nature, astral, some air. We'll see about that. Priests are average, and our dominion spreads cold. Now, since we've chosen our race, now we have to choose our pretender god. Now, this game is about you, which is the god, fighting a war of succession amongst the other pretender gods in order to become like the Pankratap Raptor or something like that, the head god. Creation. For some reason, the head god has left, and now there's this big, vacant, open spot right here. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be doing on theme for this. Now, you can tell when your god is on theme or not, because like I have right now, Son of Niefel selected. His cost is 210 points, and it's reduced by 20 points for this nation. If the cost is reduced, it's kind of on theme. Although, they're technically all theme. All on theme. There are many more gods in this, but it gives you a selection based on what you have. We are going to choose the Son of Fenrir. The Son of Fenrir is the offspring of one of the great adversaries. He is huge, a huge and very powerful wolf. He's also most cunning and skilled in the paths of water and nature. He has inherited the foul temple of his father and is prone to go to berserk if anyone opposes him. The Son of Fenrir is terrifying, and most mortals will run in fear when they see him. So, he has Fear 10, Cold Resistant 15, Stealthy 40, Berserker plus 7 for survival. He costs 90 points. He starts with 122 hit points, 13 protection, which, 10 or so is average for a person. Magic resistance of 18, a morale of 30, strength of 27, which is huge. Attack skill of 13, 10 is the average. Defense skill of 11, 10 is the average. Precision is 8, 10 is the average. There's an encumbrance, a fatigue, and a move. Doesn't play out too much with our god. And he has 1d6 Jotun wolves at his side at the start of each battle. So now that we've gotten who we are, we get to customize our god a little bit. We can change their magic scales to give them new magic, or we can change what our dominion does for the land. As your god exists and people pray to worship your god, it spreads your dominion across the land. And so it changes the land to serve what your people like. So we start out with a base of 3 cold, and that's great. We have 430 points, and we're going to do something which I typically do. We're going to put it into... Yeah, that looks pretty good. Normally I do 2 on productivity and 2 on growth as well, but I think I'm just going to put it on 1. Now, what this means is that our god is going to be very weak when it comes to casting spells, but our providences are going to be very strong. And this is something that I like to do personally with a lot of the things. I like to take these gods that can do a lot of melee stuff, not so much casting, and it usually works out fairly well. We can also change of whether our god is awake in the beginning, so we get him the first turn, dormant or imprisoned. And so dormant gives us 150 points, but the first year or so, it's actually like up to 3. He won't be available to us. And then imprisoned, it says 3 years, but I've usually found that it winds up being more 4 or 5 years. And every turn is a month, so it's quite a while before you get your god. But you get a ton of extra points to make your god, you know, super badass. So it's a trade-off. But we're going to start with our god awake, because I get pretty much what I want out of it anyway. We're going to hit OK, and we are not going to put in a name for our god. We're going to let the computer do that automatically, because they do pretty good names, I think. And our god's name is Anver. OK. Let's see. This we're not going to change too much. However, yes, we do want there to be level 2 thrones, level 1, excuse me, no, we don't want this. Hold on. Great. So this is one of the ways to get your victory, and this is the way we're doing, which is by the Thrones of Ascension. Scattered throughout the world, there are these thrones that you capture with your priests, and they give various buffs to your troops as a whole. And they also give various other effects. So level 1 thrones give 1 point. 2, 2, and 3, 3. So we need a total of 10 points to win. So you can, there's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's not right. We will bump that up there. Now there are a total of 15 points, and you need 10 points to win the game. All right, everything else looks pretty good. Let's jump into it. It's creating the world. This could take a few moments. Okay, in the beginning, there was chaos. Out of chaos rose worlds populated with multitudes of beings. Wars were fought, kings and emperors rose and fell, and civilizations were built and crumbled as millennia passed. Gods, dark and strange, were worshipped in pagan temples. Still, there was chaos. The gods fought amongst themselves, bringing even greater ruin to those who would serve them. At last there was one, a being of great power and enlightenment, who rose above his immortal peers and cast them out of the heavens into oblivion. From chaos came order, and with order came peace, and the creatures of the worlds flourished. The age of chaos had ended. Now the wheel has turned once again. The supreme god has disappeared. Prayers are left unanswered, and the smoke of offerings rises in vain to the heavens. No one knows why he disappeared, but it is certain that the people of the worlds are once again left without direction, without guiding principle, without order. Now is the time for the beings of great power and ambition to try their strength. The throne of the heavens stands empty, and only the strongest can rise to supremacy over all. Only the most powerful can ascend to take the place of he who came before. This is a time of great strife and suffering. This is a time of magic unequaled. This is the Ascension Wars! You get that every time you start a game. So, here's our map. Ooh. It wraps around, so we can see us right there. We can see us right there. Oh, we're fully zoomed out, so that's why we can see ourselves both times. It's a really pretty map, I think. And here we can see one of the Thrones of Ascension. Now, we don't know what Throne of Ascension it is or anything like that until we actually get it. But we can see what types or what the Thrones of Ascension are. So the big one is Sun, which is pretty bad for us because your dominion gains heat. And we don't like that. There's the Moon, which is level 2. The Silver Throne, which is level 2. Summer Storms, Stars, Might, Winter, Law, War, Pestilence. So if we can get Winter and the Sun, we'd be in good. But who knows? Because we want our dominion to be cold. Because our people like the cold. So, let's take a look at some of these boxes right here. We're in Niefelheim. This is the capital. It's tile number 31. Our population, unrest. How much order or so is in the province? Our defense, which is how much, it's a measure of how much we've spent for defense. You know, if somebody were to attack us, we would gain free units of a value. And it's a kind of an arbitrary value. Our income, our resources, which we'll see in a bit. Our supplies, how much supplies we're using. This is our god's name, our treasury, our income, upkeep, and our gems that we are getting. Now we're getting water and death gems. I'm going to start setting up research. And down conjuration, there are a couple of things that I would like to get down to that I just haven't seen. These are the new spells that are in blue typically that are unique to the faction, and they are new for this one, so I haven't seen them, so I'd like to see them. And we're going to do construction, which allows us to create magical items, basically. And eventually we'll start turning into some of the other things. But for now, that'll do. The first thing we're going to want to do is look at hiring some mercenaries. And they're charging us more money for mercenaries than they're actually worth. But we'll make a bid on them. We're not going to bid too much for them, however. We're going to look at our recruitment page. And we can see all the different base kinds of units we can get. From scouts to Jotun hearses. And we can see their stats right here. Remember, keep in mind, tens are average. So these guys, pretty good. Although, of course, as you can imagine, they cost it as well. You know, I'm paying more to get them than I would for pretty much anything. Here's our casters right here. We can see what magic paths they start with. And they also have a chance to gain other magic paths. This number right here is how much they research for. So they research for 15 points. And this is the big guy, basically. He is the Jarl. Or a Jarl, rather. You can get as many as you want. We start with our basic things, and down at the bottom we can see how much it costs us. So it costs us 20 gold, 17 resources. And remember, 10's pretty much average. So these people are better than average, but of course they cost a lot more. So I'll just quickly run through them. He's a big guy. These are sacred. If we had a blessing from our god, they could gain the benefit of that, but we don't really have a blessing of our god because we didn't choose to go that way. And these guys regenerate. So what I'm gonna do, since we're going with a quality over quantity, type of style, we're going to start recruiting some of our armored people and some of the skin shifters. Now the skin shifters are kind of iffy. It's a warrior of the wild who wears an enchanted wolf skin that allows the wearer to change shape into beast wolf. Into a beast wolf. Basically they have regeneration, which can really be nice, but they're only equipped with a spear and furs. So, you know, whereas these guys are pretty heavily armored, they have a protection of 16, which is decent. They have a Skelmal hauberk, an iron cap, and a shield. Shields are useful for stopping incoming arrows. And they deal 30 damage, which is a ton, believe me. We are going to wait for the first turn, not doing too much. Generally not recommended as a tactic, but I don't really care. My play is not optimized, as you will learn, but I have fun with the game, and that's what matters. Oh great, they have been bought. Oh, and Niefelheim is here, and they have a prophet now. So, let's look at Borek and his peeps. Now, as a commander, we can see he's more towards the 10. He's got a bit more defense and a bit more morale in his militia, which are 10 strength. They have a sort of crappy attack skill. 5 protection. Okay. But, you know, they didn't cost too much. So they are what they are. So we are going to change around our lines of battle teensy tiny little bit. Yeah, that looks good. No, it doesn't. Now, whoops, wrong ones. We're not actually having these two groups go together. But we can see who the commander is right here. We can see how many units, which is individual people, they can support, and how many squads they can support. Since we have two squads, they get plus one morale because of who our leader is, where we can see right here where they don't. You can add more squads to it, but then they start getting minus morale. If their morale is broken, they will turn and they will flee. So we don't particularly want that to happen. Wow, 70 barbarians there. So let's look around at these provinces. We are going to run our god and them there, and we are going to run, whoops, our scouts, or not our scouts, but our mercenaries here. We're going to make a rush right here, and we're going to see what Throne of Ascension this is. And then we're going to drop down and do the same here and here. And if we can get a hold of those Thrones of Ascension, we will be in pretty good shape. So, we are recruiting. We can do a couple more. Great. And let's end a turn. Lenka. Okay, and there were two battles. Let's view them, and then we'll see the overview of it. And you'll see where this game is a bit different than Conquest of Elysium. There's no, like, grid. Oh, I should have marked them better. Oh well. They just sort of free-for-all fight. Here are Jotun wolves that come free with their god, by the way. Big strength, nice attack skill. They can defend a little bit. Very good morale, very good hit points. They are berserk 3, which means when they take a wound, they will get plus 3 to all of their stats. But will not be able to cast or anything like that. So we can see right here, they're up to 16 and 7. Apparently defense goes down by it. But strength and attack skill go up. And protection goes up. So if they can get hit and killed all day long, we don't care in the slightest. We did lose one of our armored guys to a regular militia. That kind of feels bad. That's heavy infantry. I can understand them beating on us a little bit. That plus 4 is from this person regenerating. You can see them starting to run away. We'll speed it up a little bit. And our wolves start chasing them down. And good. So we lost one of the herdmen, which are the armored guys. So let's look and see how our mercenaries did. It may not be as good. Oh, and they've got a caster animating skeletons. Which only animates a skeleton or two. But let's check these guys out. They're Wolf Tribe Warriors. They're equipped fairly basically. Barbarian Chief, some long dead, and a shaman who is creating the people. Feel free to pause if you want to take a look at those stats a little bit more in detail. Okay. taking some hits. It's alright. Because they're getting the job done. Definitely. As long as we can get in close. Bam. And we killed their commander, so they started running. Now, they don't instantly start running if you kill their commander, I believe. But they're much more likely to. So we lost 9 of them. And they killed all of them because they were independents. So, now that we have some people here, we're going to raise their defense only by 5 to begin with. Because that's all I care about. Oh, great. So, our people... Wow, that's... Gain abilities. And he has a heroic agility. Now... This is from a unit of renown. There are only, I believe, 5 units of renown available. Don't quote me on that. At any one given time. And he has agility. So it is his attack and defense is increased. And he is ambidextrous. And they get better. Now, after these 5 people... you know... Nobody else can be in there once these 5 people get in there until one of them dies. So that's why it's not great that this mercenary commander has this heroic toughness, which is a fairly decent one and would be nice for ours. It increases his number of hit points, but what are you gonna do? Now we're still looking pretty good. Going to move our scout further towards. We are going to move them down. And we're going to move them. Ah, man, I don't want to fight all those barbarians. We're going to head towards. This right here. We're not gonna try to take it until we get some more people, but we're gonna head towards it. Can I recruit? Not at all. Very well. Who's better? She can slap people. Fantastic. Oh, and it shrinks them. Okay. Next turn. Okay. Battle in Giffa. Let's see how it does. Summoning skeletons. Oops, I still forgot to move them. Now, we're not really in a lot of danger of losing these things because our god's here. Yeah, our god's pretty crazy. You know, because we're in a place with his dominion, he's getting 24 bonus hit points. He has awe 3, which means they have to roll a dice with their morale, and they have to beat that 3, or else they can't attack him. Now, they're undead, so, you know, they have high morale, so that happens. But they're already starting to run. We can see it's red because they're broken now. I expect I won't lose a person on this one. Great. Yep, didn't lose a single person. Very nice. And in the range of shadow, let's hope we did just as well. Ah, our militia is better equipped than their militia by the fact that we have a shield. So it makes a difference. These heavy infantry could be a problem, however. But you know, to me, these are cheap, expendable, throwaway. Okay, we're doing pretty good. Now, you may see some numbers fly up that are higher than their hit points. They can be hit in different body parts as well. So sometimes, I know I just saw a 17 fly up. And of course, these guys only have 10 hit points. So chances are he was hit in the arm or something, and it did 17 damage of that, which probably knocked it off or did some sort of critical, but didn't quite kill him. But usually, it's kind of hard to go by the numbers, to be honest with you. Great. Great, great. They lost 13 people, but you know, again, they're throwaways, so I don't care about them at all. We're gonna increase. I wish I had increased our growth a little bit, because we get a little bit more income from a high growth than anything else, and we're losing some income due to the cold. So we're going to sneak him in there. It's odd that I couldn't see in there before. Oh, it's a cave. I see. I see. It makes sense now. We're going to go to recruit. Which one of these is better, really? We're going to go with one of these, even though they're slow. And I still want the best that I can buy right now, even though I have leftover resources. Yeah, I definitely should have went 2 and 2, I think, on my scales instead of 3 and 1. But you learn a little bit. We're gonna queue up our movements too. Now, it would be foolish for them to fight them, but we're going to how much longer do I have them for? One more turn? Yeah, they're not gonna. We are going to hire them for another 3 months of service. Wow, that's all of the gold I have, apparently. And we're going to try to dash them against this large thing of barbarians. Barbarians hit pretty hard, although admittedly probably not nearly as hard as we do. So it might not be a thing. And we're going to continue attacking over here. And we are going to, let's see, he's moving into here. They're moving down there. We're going to end the turn, and I think this is going to be our last turn of this. Oh. Not only did they leave us, but they joined our enemy. So that's not great. But, well, they were throwaway troops anyway, to be frank. Ah, now here we have heavy cavalry. Heavy cavalry is pretty much one of the things you don't want to see. Now, it's not going to matter too much, because we're giants and all that, but they can be really hard to hit. And they can hit pretty hard in their first attack, because they have, like, lances. And maybe he won't die, and I can show you that the lance can be used once each battle, and it's pretty hard. From a range. Better the length, pretty much the better. You get You get bonuses for high length of your weapon. Makes it easier to hit. You know, it represents it. You trying to hit first. Yeah, this is pretty much no contest, and then we're going to smack into them. Our god has 7 kills. That's not too many. When you see them flash like that, it means they're trying to hit our god, but they failed their awe roll. So that's what that is. Alright. We lost a spearman. Well, that kind of sucks. Every loss we get hurts us. Of course. We're going to go ham on recruiting these guys for a little bit. Make sure we get a nice core army of our heavily armored people. We're going to... Oh man, there's another one right there. We're going to queue up their movements and we're going to see... Can't I see what this is? No, that's a shame. Alright, anyways. We're gonna stop right here. Thanks for watching so far. If you've liked the episode, please like the episode. Make a comment. Tell me what I'm doing wrong. Actually, don't tell me what I'm doing wrong, but tell me what I could be doing better. And if you want to see more, subscribe. I'm going to be doing my best to put this game out along with some of the other things that I have coming out at the same time. So this should be a lot of fun. Alright, thanks for watching, everybody. Hope you have a great day. Peace out.